The following program does not necessarily represent the views and opinions of Reality Radio 101, its advertisers and sponsors, or its listening audience. Listener discretion is advised. Welcome to this House of Musicians with your host, singer, songwriter, and founder of the band, Inner City Outlaws, the Baritone Bear, Barry Smith, right here on Reality Radio 101. To get on board, send us an email. Our email addresses are thishouseofmusicians@gmail.com or instudio101@gmail.com. And now, right to your host of this House of Musicians radio show, Mr. Barry Smith.
Hey, welcome, listeners. Hope you're all doing well today. Welcome to this House of Musicians on Reality Radio 101. We hope you enjoy the next hour with us as we do our small part to help promote musicians, bands, and venues. Well, Gary, how are you doing?
I'm doing fine, my friend. How are you?
Doing good, man. I'm really excited to have a very seasoned professional musician on the show today, Miss Lori Yates.
Yes, very excited.
Hey.
How are you, Lori?
I'm just doing fantastic. Thank you.
That's awesome. For the listener out there, Lori's long recognized by her peers and respected as one of Canada's top talents. Lori was called alt-country long before the phrase existed, the pioneer of genre in the making. This is an artist who met Johnny Cash, hung out with Tammy Wynette, wrote with Guy Clark, Don Schultz, Colin Linden, jammed with Jerry Jeff Walker, drank with Harlan Howard. That was probably a lot of fun, Lori. Sang with Greg Allman. I know you did a duet with Greg Allman. That's super impressive. Rick Danko, Jim Cuddy, and Ate Jelly Beans with Roy Acuff. As the saying goes, you have been to the show, haven't you? How are you doing, Lori?
You know what? Just listening to that whole explanation makes me very tired.
Well, you know what? It's very impressive. So good for you.
It is. I'm kind of like, wow, who is that person? I'm like, wow, okay, that's me. It's all true.
Yeah,
no BS there. It's all true. But yeah.
I guess sometimes you just have to shake your head and go, wow, what a great time we've had, eh?
You know what? And we have, right? For all us musicians who've played for the last however many years that have gotten to play live gigs, and now we're in this weird COVID time, right, where our future is kind of uncertain with live gigs. You just have to look back and go, wow, it's been a fantastic ride. And listening to that intro of who I've got to hang out with and write with and drink with and eat jelly beans with, it's definitely been a great ride for me.
Well, that's so awesome to hear. It's a great story that you have. Now, let's start right at the beginning. You were born in Oshawa, so I'm going to ask you, when you grew up, when you were younger and you grew up, how you got influenced by music who you were listening to and how you got influenced.
I was born in Oshawa. My family's all from Oshawa and that kind of part of the woods. We left when I was about four and moved to Toronto. But my main influence was I had an uncle who was 10 years older than me. So whatever he was listening to, I was kind of listening to. But something like a memory that was really distinct when I was a kid was watching The Supremes on Ed Sullivan. Now, a lot of people have the Beatles as, a turning point for them, for themselves. But for me, it was really The Supremes and watching them sing Stop in the Name of Love. And I don't know how old I would have been, maybe like 6, 7, 8, something like that. But thinking, that's what I want to do. I want to do that. And that memory, and also riding with my mom and my dad Now, of course, this was way before seatbelts. Sitting in the middle of them, they must have been listening to it was Ferlin Husky on the wings of a snow white dove. Now, my folks were like young rockers. They were into rockabilly. They loved Johnny Cash. They didn't so much like country music. But that song was on the radio, and I distinctly remember being able to sing along with it. And at my house, you know, they weren't musicians, but there were dance parties every weekend. A lot of records played of Johnny Cash, Johnny Rivers, Brenda Lee. Remember, love Brenda Lee. My mom was a huge influence in terms of introducing me to rock and roll. Like, she grew up, you know, she saw Elvis at Maple Leaf Gardens in his gold lamé suit. Remember her taking me to the Crane Plaza at Jane Wilson, and, you know, to a diner that still had the jukeboxes, popping in a quarter and playing Bill Haley's Rock Around the Clock and telling me that was the first rock and roll record. You know, this was rock and roll, and sort of giving me the history and really, so there was always music played in my house, and I wanted to, you know, as I progressed, you know, I sang in choirs and all that kind of jazz, but in those days, at least where I grew up, it was very kind of working class and nobody took lessons, or if you had a special talent, you know, certainly nobody's parents noticed. I think my one friend, Ingrid's, you know, went to modeling school. Everybody else, we were kind of left on our own. And so, you know, I just always had a love for singing and really felt an affection for country music because I could sing it. Now, once I heard Janis Joplin, I wanted to sing like Janis Joplin, but I really didn't have those kind of parts. I was a soprano, right?
Right.
I was a soprano. I was a skinny little white chick, and I didn't sound like Janis as much as I wanted to. So my love of kind of country music sort of started maybe when I was about 13, when I was introduced to it on a serious note with these friends of mine from the East Coast who had moved up here, and their names were Brenda and Johnny and Dickie, and they had come up from Halifax, I believe, and they lived at Keel and Wilson. We all went to school. Pierre Laporte. If I'm getting too detailed, Barry, you can just like zoom ahead because you know.
Absolutely not. I'm loving to hear the story. Loving it.
Their mom and dad were like right out of the 50s. Like Johnny Dickie's mom and Johnny's dad still had a ducktail. Their mom had a beehive, a black cat eye. And this would have been like the 70s, early 70s. So this was the hairy 70s, right? Everybody, you know, right? We're all wearing those checkered jackets and those long hats. And their mom and dad were from a different era. And I remember sitting in the back of their car, and the kids were allowed to smoke cigarettes. So we were about 13, and we were smoking. You were smoking Export A unfiltered.
Wow.
Export A. And I seem to remember, now this may have all, you know, become part of the lore of the story, but there was a 5-star whiskey bottle being passed around. It couldn't have been with us kids, but maybe with the parents. And it was when we were in the back of this cavernous old boat, maybe an old beat up, maybe Cadillac, probably not. And on came Merle Haggard's I'm a Lonesome Fugitive.
Wow.
And that fused in my mind that this was the coolest thing ever. And I got that it was cool. And they loved Dolly Parton. And I had never heard of her. And they loved Peggy Tucker. And that's how I was introduced to country music was through them. And they were tough. Like Brenda would like just pop people in the head for looking at her the wrong way. So country music had this whole affinity of being, you know, really kind of cool and really kind of tough for me. So that's where I fell in love with it. And especially with Tanya Tucker, who was like a year or two older than me and her songs. And, but yeah, that whole, you know, Lonesome Fugitive, looking out the car, we're all smoking Export A's and we're 13 years old. It was fantastic.
Well, what an introduction to the music world with Lonesome Fugitive, Merle Haggard. I mean, he's one of my all-time favorites, of course. I remember, as you're saying, sitting in between my folks, sometimes on the back seat, but up on the dash by the window, and they'd be playing, like, I remember vividly Charlie Pride, cause 8-track tapes in the car, Charlie Pride. So I know exactly where you're coming from. So that's kind of cool. Now So when did you realize that you wanted to start singing, and maybe even, you know, your first time up on a stage, maybe it was like a band was playing and you got up and sang for the first time. I'm sure you must have been nervous as heck, but when did that kind of start?
Well, I wasn't somebody who, my first band, I considered myself to be quite old. I was about 17 or 18. And no kidding, right? But it's not like, oh, I'm really old, I have to be famous before I'm 25.
Right.
Hello, are you there, Laura? No, it shows she's still connected.
Yeah, seemed to have lost her signal.
They lost her signal. So she's going to have to call back in if she can hear us, or that's probably what happened.
I think she might have hung up, but there you go. I'm sure she'll call right back now. Lori has been nominated for a Juno Award, Gary, a Canadian Country Music Award, a Polaris Prize Award. The list is so long, so I'm going to talk to her about that when she comes back on.
Oh, for sure. And I read her bio as well, as I'm sure a lot of your fans have. It's pretty cool, actually, right?
Well, absolutely, man. It's impressive. She's had her lyrics immortalized in Hamilton's Core Park. I mean, it's an incredible venture that she's had. So, hey, you know, when you have that kind of success, you can definitely just always look back, and it could never be bad. You know what I mean?
Absolutely. And for the folks tuning in just now and are listening, if you'd like to ask Lori a question, you can email us. We have two email addresses for you. The first one is thishouseofmusicians@gmail.com, or the email address you see on your player window right now, instudio101@gmail.com. Either way, we will get the emails. If you have any questions at all for Lori, she'd be very happy to answer them. So write in, please.
Absolutely, yeah. I'm just reading a couple emails right now. So let's see here. I'll wait till she comes back, though.
Okay.
Yeah.
And folks,
go ahead, Gary.
Nope, I think she's back. We're going to let her back in, so hang on, please.
Okay, please tell me I'm not the first person that's ever happened.
Yeah, you're the first person. No.
I thought you said the hell with this and took off, Lori.
Sorry about that.
That's okay, dear. Where were we now? We were trying to entertain the audience while you were gone. We were doing a very bad job at it, so I'm glad you're back.
Oh, I bet you were. My first band. So my first, that was a band on Wilson Avenue. Anyways, and then my first kind of band that, it was at a Jane, way up Jane and, I want to say Jane and Highway 7. It was a farmhouse. There was a bunch of people jamming. I got up and sang. There was this bass player who approached me. He's like, hey, do you want to put it, we have a little jam band. You want to come and jam with us? I said, sure. I was just dying to play, dying to write, dying to play.
Awesome.
It turned out that this bass player, even at the time, I really wasn't aware so much, like I was, but I wasn't, it was Louis Yachtin. He had played in Lighthouse. So Lighthouse had been his last gig. But at the time, but at the time he, he just wanted to be in a party band and kind of get high and have fun on the weekend. So we have this band called Senseless with Roger Colton and Tom Kerr played drums, and Kenny's last name is flying out of my head. And, you know, we played around Woodbridge. We played the Woodbridge Hotel, and that's sort of how I started. So, and it was a cover band. And at the same time, I started in a band in downtown Toronto called The Last Resorts, which was an original kind of new wave punk band. And that's where I started writing. And we played Larry's Hideaway and The Turning Point. We got to open for Teenage Head. We also got to open for Wayne Kramer, the MC5. So I was awesome. I was doing those two things, like around 1979, I guess, around that time. That's sort of how I started. Those two bands.
That's awesome. And so do you remember what the first song was you got up when you were playing with Lighthouse's bass player? Do you remember what the first song was?
It might have been a Roseanne Cash song, because we did My Baby Thinks He's a Train. I want to say that may have been it. We used to do Pat Benatar, Roseanne Cash, Blondie, all the gals.
Sure.
Some Tom Petty.
Awesome.
I don't know if we did any more country stuff or not. I always wanted to do, when I was in The Last Resorts, there's pictures of me wearing these country shirts, right? And at that time, I remember there was this, I was always kind of singing country and leaning towards country, but not being able to find a way that it fit for me, like as a kind of a young person. And I remember my mom, you know, telling me that she's like, oh, my God, I got to take you to see these shirts. And she took me over to the bay at Lawrence and Bathurst. There was a bay there. And she said, you got to see these shirts. It's the newest craze. And it was, you know, the cowboy shirts that were all, they were satin, like hot pink satin with the fringes and everything. She said, it's the newest craze. Newest craze. It's a disco and country. And I went, it's called Crisco.
That's funny. That's hilarious, Crystal.
You know what? I should have bought one. And I did. I really should have bought one. Yeah, Crystal.
That's absolutely funny. That's hilarious. Crisco, that's what we're going to have to start calling it now. Now, sure. Before, we got an email. Now, this is impressive. This is a first on our show. Yep. We got an email at 3:45 from somebody. His name is Stan L. And this was 3:45 today. He said, hello, y'all. So excited to hear that Lori Yates will be on the radio program this evening. I love her. Such great talent. We'll be listening from Grand Island, Nebraska tonight. P.S. Your show is excellent, Stan. So you have a fan named Stan in Grand Island, Nebraska.
That's so cool.
Yeah. Here's another one.
Internet, eh?
You got to love it. It's just, you know, it's so easy to communicate back and forth now. Here's one from Monique L. And she says, what a guest. What a story. Love it. Thanks. So there you go. We have a couple
Monique.
Emails.
Thank you. That's great.
Let's talk about your studio albums. I know you have 7 studio albums, 5 solo. You have one with Rango Tango and one with Hey Stella. So how did your very first studio album, how did that all take place? Well, that must have been exciting.
Oh, totally. Well, that was the big Nashville deal, right? That was the old, Lori Yates, come on down.
Right.
You know, if you sing country music, I guess Nashville is Mecca, right? So for every country singer, you know, that's where you want to go. You at least want to check it out. Of course, it's much more worldwide, but, you know, now. But so I was thinking, I put together this roots and cowpunk band called Rangtango out of Toronto. And we rose to, you know, fast popularity.
Nice.
Really quickly, you know, which was, you know, at the time when that happens and you're young, you think, yeah, this happens all the time. And you know, you learn with time and experience that it doesn't. It's like lightning in a bottle when it happens, when it's just the right combination of people and energy and look. And so we quickly, you know, right? Everything just clicks. And so we quickly had a following, a lot of excitement, excitement from the U.S. And what started to happen was, which happens, it's kind of routine, really, but the media started to single me out in the band, right? So it was like, Lori Yates, not so much the band.
Right.
And there was a real kind of struggle with that. It's common, right? It is common. Yeah. It's a bit of a tough one as the person it's happening to.
For sure.
But you see it a lot, right? And so then it started to happen as well as the record company singling me out. And then it came down to, you know, we're interested in you. We're not interested in the band. You want this deal or you don't want this deal. So I was offered the deal of, you know, a lifetime, it seemed. And on the pretext of letting my band go. So I made a really tough decision. I said, yeah, okay, I'll take it. I feel like I have to. This is being offered to me. I don't think this deal is ever going to come along. It was put to me, you know, kind of, it was either take this or nothing. And I thought, okay, I'll do it. So I went on.
Yeah, because then when you get huge, you can go back and get the guys and have your band back. So, you know.
Well, there's options too, right, Lori? There is. And again, you know, it's like hindsight 2020, right?
Yeah.
Who knew, you know, for me, it probably was not the right decision because I love being in a band. And I have a touch of shyness. I know it's hard to believe when you meet me and stuff or you see me on stage, but, you know, to be a solo artist, you have to have a real driven, you know, personality and ego that goes with it, right? Like you have to have it, the talent for the talent, right? So that was where, with me, suddenly all eyes were on me and I didn't have a band. It was a bit overwhelming. And then, but the trade-off was getting to go down to Nashville and work with some heavy duty musicians, heavy duty writers, and have that experience.
Amazing.
So, you know, so the first record, you know, I got to write with Guy Clark, which was phenomenal. I wish it could be now. I probably would appreciate it a bit more now than I did. I was completely flipped out. There's no doubt about it.
And a little naive, yeah.
More than a little naive. I was, what, 27 or 28 years old, and I felt quite old. And I probably maybe was by those standards, music biz standards, which is ridiculous, but that's okay. And I wrote with Don Schlitz, who had written The Gambler, right? And he was huge. He was the number one writer. So when I went to Nashville, I went with my armload of songs, and I was like, here's my great song, here's my little babies. And, you know, the producers, like, they threw them out. They're like, these are good. Yeah, you can write, but we're going to set you up with some real writers.
Well,
and that was like...
That's the business, eh? Yeah.
I mean, that's the business. That's the business. Yeah. And I tell, you know, I work with a lot of young writers and I tell them that's the business. And they, you know, if you think you have any control, you should think again because you don't.
That's right.
They like you to think you might have. Go ahead.
Sure. No, I was going to say, and we'll talk about your workshop in a little later in the show. I want to play one of your songs, Lori, Promises, Promises. I believe this is from 1989. And
this is from that time. Yeah.
It is. Promises, Promises, 1989. Now, I did some research, but only found that it was just put out as a single on a 45 vinyl, because that's basically what I found out. So I don't know if it was on an album or not.
It's on an album. It's on Can't Stop the Girl, but Can't Stop the Girl is not reissued by Sony. So
got you.
You can't find that record anymore. I have a few copies. Occasionally it pops up for sale. People seem to have it, but it's not that Sony has reissued it at all.
Awesome. Well, it was pretty cool. Go ahead. Sorry.
This is a single that came out of that time. And the reason why I chose it to play just from a, you know, that was then and this is now kind of thing is because many people hear the song and then have said to me, oh, I didn't realize that was you. And I'm like, yeah, that was me. I had a friend, Tressa Levisser, who grew up in, Thunder Bay, tell me that. So just say, oh, I love that song. I didn't realize that was you. So this is a tune written with Matresa Berg, who was another hot writer at the time, who still is a hot writer down there. This is what we kind of came up with.
Excellent. Well, it's a great song. And what we'll do is we'll play the song. We'll play a couple. We'll do a shout out to our sponsors right after the song, Lori, and then we'll come back and talk about it. You are listening. Yeah, you're listening to Promises, Promises by Lori Yates on This House of Musicians on Reality Radio 101.
There was a time I was an unbeliever. I never trouble starts. When you said you love me, when you said you never leave me, I started falling for your promises, promises. You got me lying in the dark, hanging on to every word you said, word you said. Now the man in the moon is my only companion, shining through the window by my bed. Here in my room there's a candle burning. If you remember what you said, when you said you love me, when you said you never.
Back listener, we have Lori Yates on the show, and we just listened to one of her songs, Promises, Promises. Lori, welcome back. I just wanted to ask you how you came about recording that song.
Hey, Barry, thanks for having me back.
Yeah, well, we're glad you're still here.
All right.
You didn't split on us this time.
I did not yet.
Not yet.
The night is still young.
Yeah, that's right.
Hopefully not. If I do happen to just fade out, I promise I will call back. I promise I will.
Awesome.
How'd that song come about? Well, I was lucky enough to get set up with the fabulous Matresa Berg. And, you know, we were just looking for something really moody and kind of edgy. The funny thing was about at that time, you know, I mean, this was like late 80s Nashville, right? So I don't know if Michelle Wright had even been there. I don't even know if your listeners don't even know who I'm talking about here. But I think Katie Lang had been to Nashville. Maybe Michelle had been there or was about to be there. Anyways, the whole new country thing had just sort of happened or was sort of happening. And it's completely different than like what new country is these days.
For sure.
And so, you know, funny thing about that record, like, you know, Nashville thought that record was very kind of out there and very edgy. And I know my Toronto compatriots thought it was, you know, really kind of not. Right. So so we were trying to just write something sort of edgy. And I remember Matresa saying that it was very haunting. She's like, that sounds really haunting. But she said haunting. She was from the South. She was Patsy right. Cline had been her aunt. So that
wow.
was really. Yeah. Well, it was Rand, yes.
Amazing. Now, I want to just briefly touch on, I've listened to all of your albums. It's a couple songs that are my favorites that I'm going to talk to you here. I have a few,
oh, yeah?
but I want to talk to you about two of your songs. But first, I want to talk about Untogether, that album.
Uh-huh.
As yeah. I was listening to your albums, I got to Untogether and went, holy smokes, this is This is different. This is definitely a different style genre. I want to know how you came about doing that and how versatile you are at being able to do something as different as the album Untogether.
Well, Untogether came about because I had done a bunch of demos for the A&R guy at Virgin, and he hated them. And I was about to be dropped. I had done one. Record for Virgin, and then we were doing demos. And me and David Baxter, my guitar player, came in and we played him all this stuff. And we had big, you know, it was kind of country rock is what we were doing. And he's like, "Ugh, this is boring. I hate it." And he said, "Wait, what's going on with you?" And I had just broken up with my boyfriend. He was like, "Oh, I'm just kind of interested by that." And he said, "What about, you know, if I set you up with something genre wise, completely different than you've ever done before, would you be willing to do that?" And I was, you know, desperate to just pay my rent. So I said, "Sure, of course, right? If you'll pay for it, I'll do it. Sure."
Yeah, sure.
So he set me up, you know, and also I was interested. I was intrigued. So he set me up with these guys, Opium Concepts, which was three guys, Dominic Macri, Eric Ratz, and John, his last name always flies out of my head. I'm terrible, to just try some writing and recording with them. And so it was back, you know, this again is like 90s. And it was when trip hop was sort of happening, which was an English sort of sound that was coming out of England. And it was backing tracks, loops and stuff with a female singer. So it was such a real departure for me. I absolutely loved it. I love that record. I'm completely proud of it. I feel like that's where I really learned to sing. We spent a whole year making it. We spent a fortune on that record.
It's an amazing album.
Well, and, you know, it was one of the first in Canada that ever had backing tracks on for a female artist, right? It bombed spectacularly. Like, it bombed like nobody's
business. You're kidding.
6 weeks, 6 weeks out of the box, it got a very bad review from Now Magazine, which was the big magazine, weekly out of Toronto. And the record company got really scared. And also the other thing happened was the which, you know, this may have happened to you, Barry, it happens to a lot of artists. The president of the record company, he left and the new president came in. And the new president scratched his head, looked at me and said, I'm not so sure about this record. And that was it. 6 weeks later, I was standing there kind of wondering how I was going to make a living. But we made that beautiful, beautiful record. So people either, you know, love that record or they hate it. And at the time, it left, like, I loved it. And I've had people, you know, at the time were saying to me, you know, you're one of the best country singers around. What'd you do? And I just really needed a break from country music to be able to sing something
Absolutely.
Else, right? Just
sure.
do something else. So.
Of course, you want to broaden your horizons. You want to broaden your horizons. Absolutely. Lori, we have another email. This one's from Spring C. Yes, her name's Spring C. And it says, "Hello, everyone. Love the show. Listening from Toledo, Ohio. Lori, do you have a website so you can direct people who are listening to the show how they can find some more information on you?"
I do. It's www.loriyates.com. And it's, you know, it's fairly up to date. It's not like it's me who does it. I'm letting the cat out of the bag.
Nice.
So yeah. But you can join my guest list. Is that what it's called? Yeah.
Sure.
And you know, I don't send out a lot of stuff, but I do when I have things going on, and I try and keep in touch a couple of times, you know, every couple of months, sort of thing. So yeah. Yep.
Awesome. I'm just going to keep reading emails. They're coming in left and right here, Lori. This is from Jane D. She says, "Hello, I love Lori. Such a very talented musician. Thanks." So that's from Jane.
Aw, thanks, Jane. I love you too.
Here's one from Walter P. "Howdy from Calgary, Alberta. New listener here. Loving it. Rock on." One more here, Lori.
Thanks, Walter.
See, Justin L. says, "What a song. Phenomenal. Lori, you rock, girl."
Thanks, Justin. Thanks a million. Appreciate it.
So there you go. Absolutely. Absolutely. I want to talk briefly about a couple of my songs I'm fond of yours here. Walking Wounded from the 2007 album. I believe it was 2007 from the book of Minerva.
Minerva, yeah.
Minerva. So explain to me how you came about that song and why you named the album The Book of Minerva.
Well, that record was a real departure for me because it's when, I don't know, I just had a real calling to make an acoustic record without any reverb on my voice. It drove my co-producer crazy. I wanted a very stripped down sound. I wanted a very basic sounding, you know, I played guitar on every track, and that was the first time I'd ever done that. I I've been playing guitar for years. I'm not a great guitar player, but I can, you know, hold a rhythm. And it just, it was coming out of a really creative time for me. So Walking Wounded, where that phrase came from, I'm not really sure. It was one of those sky songs, you know, or sky ideas. Mm-hmm. They just come from the sky and they just land, and you're able to grab them and you put them in a book, and then you maybe open that book up 6 months later and are able to write on it. So Book of Minerva was a time that the songs were falling out of my guitar. Every time I picked my guitar up, I couldn't stop writing. It was really something. And it was amazing. I wish it always was like that. I wish I could tell everybody it was always like that. It's my experience, it's not, but I've experienced that a couple of times. And so it was a real true to who I am record. You know, and I felt like, okay, these, you know, didn't want to put a lot of instrumentation on it, doesn't have any drums on it. And I've had that song, a couple of people have covered it. Jada Kelly covered it. A guy named Jack Bird in England covered it. So,
nice.
It sort of resounded with people.
You got to love that. And I get goosebumps when you say songs. There's a period of time when songs just fall out of the sky, because it happens to me too. They just come out of nowhere. And sometimes they have a meaning to something in your life and sometimes they don't. So I totally relate with what you're saying there.
Mm-hmm. Definitely.
Let's play the next song that we're going to play here. I know this is from Sweetheart of the Valley. Now, I believe this is your last album, solo album. Is that correct?
Yeah. That's 2015.
Yeah. How did you come up with Sweetheart of the Valley? The title for the album,
Yeah, just from the song title. You know, when I write, and I always see my songs have a place, and they're like little movies, and they have characters in them, and somehow the song Sweetheart of the Valley, which we're not going to play, maybe I'm not going to talk that much about it, I don't think that's the one we're playing. Are we, we're playing Trouble in the Country? Is that what we're playing? Yeah, okay. I wanted to, you know, one of my longtime bands and my longtime friends, Hey Stella, which play on the record, and Hey Stella are David Gavin Baxter, who's played guitar with me for years and is also my co-producer, Basil Donovan, who plays bass, and Basil plays in Blue Rodeo, and Michelle Joseph, who plays drums in Hey Stella. So, you know, probably honestly the best alternative country band going, right?
Nice.
So they play, I wanted to do sort of a split between, I wanted to have them on the record and do, so they're backing me up on Sweetheart of the Valley. And that's, the title came from the song. And it's just, you know, the Sweetheart of the Valley of any valley. I suppose Dundas is close by. They call that the valley town, but it's not specific to that. No.
Awesome. Well, we've had Basil on the show, and what a gentleman, what a super nice guy. He was just so easy to talk to, like yourself, and just a fabulous guy, Basil Donovan. So we were honored to have him on the show as well. And I know, like you say, he plays in Hey Stella with you. And I'm sure that when everything gets back up and running, you guys will you be back at the Cameron House? Will you still be playing with Hey Stella?
Well, you know, we did a regular Tuesday night there for about 2.5 years, and what a dream gig. It was so much fun. 8 to 10 on Tuesdays, Would we would love it. Of course we'd love it. We'll have to see. Don't know what the future holds, you know, for any of us really, right, Barry?
Like, right.
In terms of live gigs, certainly it doesn't look like it's going to happen this year. Hamilton is in stage two. Toronto's still in stage two. And yeah, it doesn't look like it at this point. But if there's a possibility that I hope the Cameron's been able to hold on, Cosmo, the Ferrero brothers, they own the building. So, you know, hopefully they've been able to hold on to it, and they've been huge supporters of music. Like, it's one of the last places in Toronto that was having music 6 nights a week, right? So we'll see. We hope so, but I don't know if we can count on it.
Sure. And you got some impressive band members in Hey Stella. As you mentioned, David Baxter, he started playing guitar with David Wilcox. He's worked with Alanis Morissette, Papa John Phillips. I mean, just in very impressive musicians here. I know Michelle Joseph has played drums with Etta James and Prairie Oyster, Long John Baldry. Just impressive musicians that you have playing in Hey Stella. Mm-hmm. That must be, like you say, a wonderful gig to do.
Oh, it's fantastic. It's like a music lesson. And it's like, they're like family, you know, they're my family. So it's
it's
phenomenal. So I miss them. Miss them like crazy. Yeah.
I'm sure you do. Well, let's go ahead and play Trouble in the Country off your 2015 album, Sweetheart of the Valley. Listeners, that's what we're going to do right now. We have Lori Yates on the show. And again, this is Trouble in the Country from Lori's 2015 album, Sweetheart of the Valley, on This House of Musicians on Reality Radio 101. You better than the rest. welcome back, folks. We have Lori Yates on the show. And we just listened to Trouble in the Country off her 2015 album, Sweetheart of the Valley. Lori, tell me a little bit about how you came up with Trouble in the Country.
Well, Trouble in the Country is kind of a true story. It's about going and meeting Billy Sherrill, famed record producer, very first time. And, going to meet him. And, you know, it was early in the morning, probably too early for him. The A&R guy is dragging me in there. And, of course, I'm all, you know, big-eyed and freaked right out. And he's like, Larry, who are you bringing me now? Who's this? He goes, last week you brought me a stripper named Candy Kane. and he looks at me and he says, you know, there's only one redhead in Nashville, and that's Reba. That's what he said to me. And he was serious. He was serious. Yeah, scary. There's only one true redhead. He was nasty. I didn't like him. And I'm like, I don't want to work with this guy. Now, sometimes I think, you know, later I thought, well, maybe I should have overcome that and just worked with him anyways. But he was nasty and he was not interested in it. But so on that recording, I had you hear the lead stuff is the fabulous Stephen Miller playing guitar, as well as David Baxter. But Stephen Miller, who's, you know, he's out of Brantford these days. He's from Upper New York State. He was out of Toronto for years. But the backup group, Hamilton's The Bad Girl Chorus, I have Rita Shirelli singing there, Tara Lightfoot, Tressa Levisour, Mary Simon, Ginger St. James, Dottie Cormier, Lena Monteclavo, Buckshot Beebe, Mimi Shaw. So a whole bunch of great Hamilton singers.
Awesome.
And yeah. So it was kind of about, that song was just about how I thought country was in trouble.
Well, it's definitely, it's a nice upbeat song, and it's very bubbly, that's for sure. Great song. Got another email. This is from Alexis B. Loving your guests on the show every week. Where do you find these folks? Sweet. Stay healthy from Boulder, Colorado. One more here. Fantastic music and guests. Very talented. Thanks, Barry Bear, for a great show. Stay healthy. That's from Madden W. So thank you.
That's
thank
so
you
nice.
For that.
Wow.
Yeah. It's nice
cool.
to have. I love it when people send emails and input with for the artist and whatnot too. So
that's awesome.
Now you have something special going on, and it's been going on for 4 years. I want to talk about your creative genius songwriting workshops. It's just such a cool thing to do. Why don't we touch on that for a little bit and explain what that's all about, Lori?
Yeah, well, about five years ago, you know, I was just thinking about back when I had first started and, you know, what I needed assistance and support with, right? And when I moved to Hamilton, a lot of people were asking me, you know, a lot of young musicians asking me about the experiences I had and how I could support them. And I wanted to kind of give back, but, you know, without that, you know, without, anyways, just trying to figure out a way to do that. So I had this idea of, you know, having this creative genius songwriting workshop, which would be write the songs, record the songs, and perform the songs all in 6 weeks. And that me as the facilitator of that would put that in place. So I would get the gigs for people, I would get the studio for people, for the group, and people would just have to show up and do the work. And I give people prompts. So the first time I ever tried it, I thought, well, I'll just see if anybody's interested. I kind of stuck my toe in the water, hung out my sign, and bang, it was filled up. And I've done, I think, 27 of them now.
Wow.
So a lot of people have come through, and at the end of 6 weeks, people who've written, you know, varying degrees of experience. I've had people come through that have never written a song in their life to, you know, a person who was the band leader for the Women's Blues Review. So lots of experienced musicians, a lot of people who've never written or play an instrument at all, take the workshop and are able to write two songs by the end of the workshop. Because we meet for like three, well, we used to meet in person. So I've done it online twice now, and it translates really nice online. So I do a Zoom group, and so I give prompts I talk about writing. I talk a lot about and work with people also as a songwriting coach and a performance coach around, you know, people's inner critic and the stuff that holds you back as a performer or a writer. And that's the kind of the stuff that we deal with in the workshop. And I give prompts that each week the writers come back and then present their songs. So you're not sitting there as a writer, you know, looking at a blank page, because that's often very intimidating, right? Mm-hmm. And then within that, people meet with me one-on-one online now. I go over their songs. I kind of, you know, very gently give a critique. I'm all mm-hmm. about positive support. I don't really think criticism works. I think it's not for creativity anyways. And mm-hmm. and then people play the songs for the other group. And out of that, you know, a bond forms with the other writers. I've had maybe 4 or 5 people that had never written before that have gone on to make their own CDs and gone on to do gigs because that's what they wanted to do, right?
That's
not
great.
Everybody wants to do that. Yeah, so it's totally inspiring. Like, I love it. I get a great blast out of it to be part of it. Yeah, and well, witness people do that. So
good for you, Lori. That's awesome. And like you say, you're being very supportive of people who may not be as experienced, like you say. Now, Lori, I have a segment that I like to call, Well, Gary, What Do You Think?
Yeah, beautiful. And always excellent. I mean, I don't know. It's kind of, I think Lori's music, now I don't know if she'll be offended by this or she'll be happy by it. It reminded me a little bit of Dolly's music down in Nashville.
Oh,
you know,
that's nice.
Same kind of vocal presence and same kind of tone in her voice. Very talented, great range. I loved it, to be honest with you.
Thank you awesome. So much.
Yeah, for sure.
That's a great compliment.
Well, thank
yeah,
you.
Totally. Yeah.
And Lori, that's coming from Gary Labar from the band Walkers K, who are number one in South Africa right now. So definitely wow. a nice compliment. Yeah. Lori, what do you have on the go right now? What are you doing?
Well, I'm in COVID. So I've been doing a lot of gardening. I'm just about to launch another workshop online. So if anybody listening is interested at all, just take a look at my website. I should have that up in the next week or so. I've got tons of songs always.
Are you working on a new CD?
I'm always working on a new CD, Barry. Like I have been for the last couple of years. My thing, I'm a great starter, having a bit of a hard time finishing these days. So that's where I'm at. But yeah, hopefully when we're allowed to, you know, get back in the studio and I mean, a bit of a stumbling block for me has been how to put something out these days, right? That's been, you mm-hmm. put out a CD, do you put out a single, how do you release it, right?
Yep.
So I've been scratching my head on that one for a few months, just trying to figure that out. But yeah.
We
yeah.
all have.
So, I know, right? Like, we're just kind of not sure what to do. So I've got new material and I've been doing some Facebook Live shows, which have gone over great. I'm always surprised by that, but they do. And I do more of those, even though people are starting to, I guess they're playing on patios, but it seems kind of odd, the patio mm-hmm. gig. I don't know about it, but anyways, I'll be doing more of those too. And yeah, people can look for me on Facebook or on my website. Yep.
Excellent.
And more music, hopefully.
Yeah, well, you know, this isn't going to last forever. I'm sure they'll get a vaccine and it might be another year maybe or however long and it'll be over. So I think it might not be back to completely the way it was before, but I think it'll get pretty much back to some normality where bands will be playing back in bars and people will be making, well, I don't know, like you discussed about, you don't know what format to put your music out on. And you wonder if I make 300 or 1,000 CDs, am I going to sell them? I mean, maybe at live gigs you might sell mm-hmm. some, but, and you know, the darndest thing is if you put your music on Spotify, which you have and I have and a lot of musicians do, yeah. you basically get peanuts for it. So
Yeah, you get nothing. It's really, yeah, I mean, I try and explain that to people. You know, I used to do that from the stage. Sometimes it got a little preachy. I never meant it to be, but where when people were buying, you know, where their money's actually going, right? For a musician, if you're buying from Spotify, like, we're getting paid in cents. Like, it's pretty bad, right, these days.
Definitely.
Yeah, yeah.
Definitely really bad. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Well, you know what, Lori? What can I say?
Barry, I just want to let you know. I don't mean to interrupt you, but I just sent through two emails to you, last-minute emails, so you might want to wait till those come in and read those to Lori.
Sure. These two last emails right here?
Yeah, I just sent them through, so I'm sure you got them by now.
Absolutely. This one's from Eric N. He says, staying healthy, listening to Thom, this House of Musicians. He says, wear your mask, folks, but don't cover your ears so that you can hear Barry and the crew each week rocking on. that's pretty nice.
That's
there.
Great.
And funny. This one's from Glenn W. Love your guest tonight. Amazing. Thanks for a great show. That's from Glenn W.
Aw, that's so nice. That's great. Very
well,
nice.
Lori, what can I say? It was an absolute honor. I know you've done a lot in your career and hung out with a lot of great people as yourself, and you're a wonderful singer. You have great CDs, folks. Please get out there and look on Spotify or any of your favorite music sites and buy something from Lori Yates. Buy a song, but listen to her stuff. She's absolutely amazing, original singer-songwriter. So, Lori, what can I say? It was an honor to have you on the show. Thank you for coming
on.
Thank you,
Barry. Thank you so much for having me on and get me. I actually had to go and look at my bio. I was like, oh, I haven't done an interview in a while. I didn't want to like zone out. I'm like, oh, what was that guy's name again? So thank you so much. I appreciate you asking me. And Gary, thank you so much for running the board.
You're
there.
Welcome. Thank you, Laura.
Whatever it is you do there.
Yeah. Thanks, Laura.
Yeah, you guys are really awesome. Thanks a million.
Yep. Thank you, Lori. And as soon as you get back at it and out there playing, we'll get you back on the show. We'll also promote where you're playing. Thank you again. And to the listener, I say thank you for being here and always dance and sing and let the music bring your soul to the surface for all the world to see. Until next time, have a shuffle your feet kind of week and good night. You've been listening to This House of Musicians on Reality Radio 101.
Thank you for listening to This House of Musicians with your host, singer-songwriter, and founder of the band Inner City Outlaws, the Baritone Bear, Barry Smith, right here on Reality Radio 101.